come to the last working session, and that would be on Suramya, Serene, Beautiful Goa, Santulit, Balanced Goa, and most importantly, Swanandi or Happy Goa. And I have great privilege in inviting Mr. Rahul Deshpande, practicing architect and former member of state level committee on Goa's regional plan. Rahul.
Good evening, all of you here. I mean, after Oscar's talk, I feel almost like a dwarf on the stage. But I'll try my best to say what I want to. First, let me thank the organizers for having me here to share the days with Dr. Mashalkar. It's said in, there's a saying in Kogni ki, Saat Janma Meet Khaan Chapattal hai. So to be on stage with him, so thank you very much the organizers for having me here today to share my views. And secondly, also I would like to thank the organizers. I don't know whether I want to thank them, but you know, during the time of Parshuram, there used to be these discourses when the kings would come and there used to be a yajna, or you know, there used to be a home done, and at the end of it all, there would be a slaughter, there would be an animal who would be slaughtered. So as I am the representing the regional plan, which is the most controversial, so I think the organizers have cleverly kept it at the end, my talk, so I can be sacrificed and slaughtered. So I don't know how tactfully it was done, but that's the way it is. Can we have the lights off, please? So this is Goa Vision 2035, and what I've been asked to speak today is on three things: that Surmi, that is Serene Goa; Santuli, that's sustainable; and Swanandi, happy Goa. And there's another thing which I find here is everybody here has been given one topic to talk on. I've been asked to speak on three topics, and I've been given only 15 minutes. Not fair. So I'm going to request Dr. Mashalkar to give me 5 more minutes, if at all.
Done. I'm in a very generous mood today. So
okay. Thank you very much. Well, I'm going to be speaking, I was asked to speak on this with reference to the regional plan, and all I had to say, because I was on the task force with Oscar and then on the SLC to make the regional plan, and I said, we've taken care of all of this, so what do I talk about? So it's a big document, and it's a huge area to cover up, it's a tall order. So what do I cover up with? So I thought, And the document, vision document, praises the regional plan, which is quite a rarity to hear. It praises the regional plan, saying that it's a very good document and it should be implemented by the government. And it also mentions about one specific policy called ecotourism policy. So I have an explanation at the end of my presentation on ecotourism, because I think there is a lack of understanding of what we've done. But having said that, to touch upon these things or these various topics, I picked up something that's very crucial to me at this point of time, because by 2035, if we don't address the problem we have now, we will not have this beautiful, serene, sustainable and happy Goa at all. So I thought this would be the session where probably it would be a very physical problem which I will address through my presentation. But before I get into that, what is a serene, sustainable and happy Goa? So I thought, I knew that this would be a very serious session all day long, so I made a small film about Goa, the essence of Goa. It's going to take 2 minutes, and it's got song and dance, and it's, the music is by A.R. Rahman, so it speaks very well. So you see, all that I have done, because I know I'm going to get slaughtered at the end of it all, so I'm just preparing ground and trying to be good to you.
Thank you.
Or the essence or happiness of Goa. So I tried to capture these three things in what we have right now and which we think we should maintain or have it for till 2035 or posterity for that matter. The question is that will this beautiful Goa really last till 2035? That's what we're looking at and beyond. But the way things probably are going, and as I'm saying, it's very physical at this point of time in terms of beauty, and I'm going to talk in terms of the planning perspective, you know, because this is a very planning issue. So I'm restricting my scope to planning. And if you see on your left-hand side, and then you see what you have on the right-hand side. So this is the beautiful Goa, what we all think of is houses of such beauty to what we have on the right-hand side. Is this is what is happening to Goa right now. On the second part, if you were to just see, this is what a beautiful landscape we have, and what you have on next is just next door, is Aldea de Goa. It is just cut across a hill, and you have a massive development which has cut in our hills and our natural heritage, as you may call it. So where does that leave us? I mean, can Goa be really saved? Can we really be saved from these atrocities that are happening right now? Well, in terms of planning aspect, yes, there is a solution to how these things can be treated, and this is done worldwide. This is not something that I am speaking about, which is completely reinventing the wheel. And how is it done? That this is density control and architectural control of the building typology. Both of these, if it is implemented and brought about, we could think of saving Goa or the beautiful Goa that we're looking at. Now, before I get into density control, what is desired? What is desired for a Goa or a city to be? And I'm just giving you an example here in I'm looking for the pointer which was supposed to be here.
Oh, here.
There I go. See, if this were to be a city, which is, you look at it from the sky, and what should happen actually is this city should be planned in a way where you have high-rise buildings or the commercial areas, followed by a mixed use. If you see here, this is the tall buildings. The roads are much wider there. And then you have mixed use, and then you have residential areas at the end of the city. This is an example of Boston. And you see the downtown where we have the tall buildings, then you have the mid-use, and these are the residential suburbs. Which means that when the city is planned, infrastructure here, roads are made wider here, water power is given to them as they require it, and so on and so forth till here. So there is a planned city done here. But unfortunately, what we have with us is something that you see here. This is India, because here what happened was someone met the PDA chairman and got this converted to C1 zone. This happened to be C2 zone, and there's a residential thing here. So what has happened in Goa is that you have a tall building in the middle of nowhere as compared to what it should be. Therefore, the kind of city that gets developed, you are bound to have traffic jams, you are bound to have issues of water, because the infrastructure isn't planned this way. In this way, the infrastructure is planned. So what I'm trying to say is density control is something that has to be brought in. And when I mean by densities, it is the FAR. And this is mentioned in the report, the vision document, that how FAR should be controlled. And this is one example of how we could bring about our new cities to address these issues of what I just saw, destruction of Goa. In terms of building typology, which I just mentioned to you, what is desired? This is an example of a city in Europe. It's Greece. And if you see the buildings out here, all of them have a typical typology, similarly here. And the rules, regulations, specify a certain kind of building typology that should be there for a city or a village or a town. And that is why things look like this. Things have a certain style, and this actually did was prevalent when you look at our houses in Fontainebleau or in Comba in Margao. There was a sense of consistency which we don't have, and what we have right now, if I have to show you, is something like this. This is what we have presently in Goa. This is the Kalambut, which is supposed, the photograph on top is Kalambut, and this is in Panjim city. So we have a most hideous building typology that there is, because there is no control, architectural control, on how building should look. We have a lot of emphasis on what should be the size of a bathroom or what should be the size of a room, but how it should look and appear. And the appearance finally makes what a city looks like. And unfortunately, we have extremely pathetic aesthetics that have finally come out in the open. I mean, my fraternity is responsible for it, nevertheless. But at the end of the day, I want to ask a question. Can we ever have a beautiful suburb like this, and probably a sustainable Goa of this particular kind? Is it really ever possible? To really understand this, we have to understand the context of Goa. And we have to understand Goa's land use. What is this Goa's land use all about? What are the problems? Why we are not getting what we are getting? The present problems on hand, and the solutions to these problems, if at all we can handle them. That's the supply and demand, regulations to address the building typology, and create new high density areas. This is what I would like to just mention. So if you look at Goa the way it is now, and if I were to look at its land use, I have made it into a chessboard, and you see some green squares, blue squares, and some orange squares. What I'm just trying to say is, if my land use was something is green, is eco-sensitive. Eco-sensitive is something that we have defined in the regional plan, is something that's very sacred. It can't be touched. Our paddy fields, our hills, Kazan lands, what have you. Then there is settlement, which is settlement on industrial, that is unique. In terms of settlement, means what can be used for human consumption is in orange, and industrial is something industrial or commercial which you use for livelihood. So if I were to look at this in this way, and if I were to stack them all together, so this is eco-sensitive, and this is industrial land, to make it much more simpler in terms of making a presentation. So what's on the left-hand side is eco-sensitive. It can't be touched. If you want Goa to be beautiful or what have you, I can't touch eco-sensitive. These are our lungs. This has to remain for posterity. It is going to give us, as Daryl said in the morning, this is what's going to feed the settlement area. So it can't be touched. Now, what I want to speak about is what is happening on that other square, which is the settlement square. Now, well, this settlement, what we have, where you see the slide coming up now, what we have consumed presently is marked orange, which is for the present population here. This is whatever is marked is for the present population. And what probably a regional plan plan every 10 years is supposedly to do is to mark this additional place or add additional sediment to bring it in use for the next generation. And this is what attempt has been done by this regional plan. But you would see that there is an enormous, and the what is left in between is for our future generations. Because this is an important fact that we all should know, that this is for future generations, because the only thing in acute short supply is land. God or nature has stopped manufacturing land. As compared to any fossil fuel or energy, we may shift from fossil fuel to solar, from solar to nuclear. We will have our cars running in any case. We will find an alternative. But I don't think we'll have an alternative to land. Especially in Goa, we have a very small land mass which can be used for human settlement. Unlike other states like Maharashtra, Karnataka, or what have you, there are huge tracts of land. We in Goa, one side is of course the sea, the other side are the western ghats, which are eco-sensitive, we have a small belt for human settlement. And we have to be very, very conservative about how much of it we are going to consume or use for future generations. But there is an issue here. There is an enormous demand to convert and consume this. The question is why? I mean, we aren't growing that much. Our decadal population increases only 14 to 15%. So why is there huge demand to consume this? Well, what Yatim mentioned this morning in his talk was over-increasing land and real estate price in Goa. I'm just giving you a comparison. In 2005, Goa was 3,000 rupees a square meter in terms of land cost, and the flat used to cost around 12,000 rupees a square meter.
If I have to look at it, for what it means, that 15,000 land price and the flat price is around 45,000. This is a 300% increase. Donapal, which we are here right now, which was at 5,000, is now selling between 60 to 70,000 rupees a square meter, which is a 1,200% increase. What on earth has happened? I mean, is the population growing so much that the land prices have to go beyond this particular percentage? Is a big question that we need to answer. And if you ask any economist, the economist will say, wow, the real estate industry is booming. So great, is bringing a lot of bucks into the economy, stamp duty and what have you. And the height of it is, who is selling this land? Goans are selling this land. So Goans are selling lands, getting richer. So it's a win-win situation and happy situation for everyone. So who is complaining? And why should we complain about this demand? Just keep on converting whatever we have, and that's it. Everyone gets richer. But mind you, this phenomenon is destroying Goa and making it uglier on two fronts. This is very, very serious. So I'll give you an example. If you look at the slide on the right-hand side, this is what our Goa skyline is, that we have trees as it compares on the slide on the left. And because of this sudden demand in land prices and the real estate becoming very booming, we have this kind of structures coming up and destroying our Goan landscape. Now, this is something that we all know, and we all keep complaining about that, you know, builders are building these buildings and that is why Goa is getting much uglier. But there is another effect which is happening, which we all know but yet don't know. Or we don't want to admit that we know it. And that is about our Goan villages. The graphic representation shows you a Goan village which had houses on the left hand side here. And this is how a typical Goan village was. What normally happened till 2005 was a builder construct a small kind of a flats in the village itself, or on the outskirts of the city. For example, in Mersheys or Santa Cruz, a building would come something like this. The person from the village, once his family grew, all he did was he would just go and buy a flat here. He would keep the character of his old house or old home the way it was. And thereby, think, if you just see our villages till 2004-2005, the character, the texture of our villages remained the way they were. Because he could afford to go and buy a flat here. Today, I don't think any Goan, at least I cannot afford a flat anymore, either in the village or in the city. The prices have gone way beyond any government's reach. And therefore, this phenomena which has happened and which is very, very serious as regards to Goa is concerned, is he has started building illegal structures. These illegal structures, if you see, are destroying the very fabric of how our villages looked. He can't afford a flat, but he needs to expand his family. He has a physical need to grow. How does he grow? So he just pays the sarpanch a little bit, the secretary a little bit, and right on the street you have got this kind of structures coming up. This is right opposite my house, in any case, in Mirshis, where I live. And it's an illegal structure which has come up, and it's going on. And this is the kind of destruction of Goa, its beauty, what we may call it. So what I'm trying to say is, by 2035, this is the kind of Goa we had, and what we are going to end up with is something like this. Still, until we don't look at it very seriously. Now, what's the problem, and why is this happening? What happened from 2004-2005? Who is responsible for this demand? Well, as I said, it happened in 2004-2005, and as Mr. Tibble mentioned it in his talk this morning, it started with our neighbor from here, with Aldia de Goa. They developed a property here which is on the seafront, and exactly in 2004, the prices were around 3,000-4,000. My friends have brought properties there for 3,000-4,000 rupees. Shah Rukh Khan bought the property there. Overnight, the property jumped up to 25,000 rupees a square meter. The neighboring thought that if they can get 25,000, why shouldn't I get 20,000? And then the chain began. And it so happened, in the circles of Delhi, Bombay, or what have you, the affluent India, Goa became a must-have. Goa mein agar, well, Goa mein toh ghar hona hi chahiye. Old Portuguese home toh hona hai, and the beach view ka toh home hona hai. This became a fashionable, and people began to invade Goa, literally. And buying land at any price. Goans were more than happy to sell their land because they were getting the price they wanted. So what I told you about 5,000 rupees a square meter is gone about to 60 to 70,000 now, is all land being bought in this process. Once this started, the builders saw that there's a huge potential. The speculators were always looking for a good investment, started pumping in money into Goa. Large projects started coming in. Huge mega projects, as they came in, started coming, and you could see this huge destruction somewhere around 2005-2006. That's when Oscar and company, the Goa Bachao Andolan, raised their voices, and you know what happened. And when you saw this happening, the politicians who were there found a great tool of converting land very easily, and that's why you had the regional plan 2011. And we know what all happened with it, with so many people involved and politicians involved there. Now, what has happened now is this trend of having a second home in Goa is so fashionable that you have large buildings being constructed all around, which are actually used or not used at all. Probably someone comes here for New Year's and the whole area is kept, the whole apartments are empty. They have ghost colonies, if you were to ask me. And the point what is happening is, please understand what is really happening, is this land which I had kept for my future generations is getting consumed for a ghost colony, and my land is getting destroyed for no reason. This is an extremely serious problem that we have on hand. Now, can we stop this trend? Is it at all possible for us to reverse this? Well, is there a way? And most importantly, is there a political will to handle this? Is there a political will? Well, there is of course a solution to everything that we look at. And the main issue is the supply and demand. RP2021, the regional plan that we were involved with, studied this problem in great detail, and we proposed policies to regulate the supply and demand. And we looked at both the sides, and that's what finally came about. First, we said about the supply. Supply is how much you can build. So we curtailed what could be built by introducing a high density village and a low density village. In the sense, any village that is neighboring a city is a high density village where you have an FAR of 0.8 or 80. The other villages have been brought down to 60. So therefore, what you can build and can come out to the market is less. You also reduce the heights of the buildings, so you know the buildings look a little sober, and the heights of the buildings are now restricted below 9 meters because the height of a coconut tree is 11 meters. So it's very important for a Govan that a coconut tree is in our psyche. So all the buildings have been kept below the height of a coconut tree. So this is what was introduced in the regional plan. And that's the plan on the side which shows you which are the high density areas and low density areas. The second very important thing is to discourage the demand. Now, please remember that in case I cut the supply by seeing that less can be built, so that means less number of buildings will be built or built up areas will come into the market. But in case I don't cut the demand, and the demand is by non-Govans, and when I mean non-Govans, people who have got nothing to do with Goa, but just to keep it as a prestige symbol that I have Goa mein mera ghar hai. This kind of a demand has to be cut in. Unfortunately, the government, the last government implemented our supply part, but the demand part has not been taken care of. And therefore, whatever less is now available is been grabbed further by, let's call the word non-Govans. I'm not very comfortable with that word, non-Govans. But to make it simpler, they are grabbing that because they have the money power to buy those flats at high, or land at that high prices. And so Govan is still affected, as of now, on non-affordability of real estate in Goa itself, in their own motherland. So this is a very serious issue. So what we proposed in the regional plan was to have a no-occupancy tax. And this is what we, all the members of the SLC, have been shouting from rooftops to get it as fast as possible. And what we are saying is, if you are not contributing to Goa in any way, but having an apartment here, or a building or a villa, pay an extremely high tax. This is done worldwide. Annual high tax. For example, what we had proposed, though we had not mentioned a figure, if you have a two-bedroom apartment, annual no occupancy tax would be 1 lakh rupees. If you do not, if you have a three-bedroom or a villa, it is 2 lakhs and above. Every year you have to pay. The reason for this is, if you are a citizen of this country, you have the right to come and live here. But if you want to live in Goa, we are a premium state. Pay for the state. You want a Maruti 800, stay in Delhi. You want a Mercedes-Benz, come here. Pay the price of Mercedes-Benz. That's what Goa should be. Having said that, we further propose that this amount which is collected should go to the panchayat directly. Panchayat can use it for their in their work, and they could use this money for their developmental works. Now, if we were to bring this in, just imagine the number of people who are hoarding flats or investors who have invested. If they have to pay 1 lakh rupees every year, they're going to sell those flats tomorrow right away. All that will come in market. Imagine the slash of the real estate prices that will happen. It's a matter of fact. But can this really happen? We had a discussion with the present government on this issue. Because once we proposed this, there was all agitation, so things were kept on hold, election code of conduct, what have you. And what we were told is, no, this may not be possible because if you are a citizen in the country, you can come and buy anything anywhere. We can't differentiate. But I asked a very simple question. But I'd like to have a glass of water first. The question that I would like to ask is, we have this differentiation to say that you can, any citizen can come into Goa and buy what he wants. But we have made a separate rule for education. If children, we do not let children from other states come in and study in our schools unless we have a domicile here. Am I right? So why can't there be a domicile condition for buying real estate in Goa is the question we are asking. You agree with me?
Yes.
So in case if domicile can be applied, see, even if there is a citizen or a child a student from Maharashtra to come here, he has to have 5 years in the state, he has to be born in that state, and he has to pass 10th and 12th to get a university course in any of our university courses. Why should the same be applied for land in Goa? Because Goa has very limited land. This is not being very regional in terms of being a Shiv Sena kind of a mentality. It is truly because we have very less land, and the problems that we are going to face are going to be huge. So this is what we have proposed. Next, of course, is to address the building typology. We should have regulations. We should set up an urban art commission to see that there are controls in the way the building look. And this is very important, is to save our cities. We have very beautiful cities. And this is my last slide, because Dr. Vashilkar has already seen that my time has gone way out. If you look at a city, or let's say this is a Panjim city or Margaon, the green spots are the spots which I'm talking about are gardens. The red are the ones which are already constructed. The blue ones are probably a fontanous area or a comba area or what have you, which we need to protect. But considering the market forces, we are compelled, the market forces are compelling these buildings to be demolished, destroyed, and high story buildings to come in. We can't even restrict that because the city has to grow. The new generations need venues or avenues to construct new buildings. So if you see that in Panjim city, the planners had a forethought and they planned up a Pato Plaza area. What they did was they reduced the FAR from the city and increased it in Pato Plaza. So a completely satellite kind of a city happened, and the whole center of gravity of the city changed to Pato Plaza. So it took care of 25 years. What has happened now, Pato Plaza, I'm giving an example of Panjim, is full. As soon as it is full, now 2 years back, you see again there is a lot of real estate development happening in the city of Panjim. Because we have not created another Pato Plaza. Every 25 years, we will have to create another city kind of, a satellite city or satellite business center, which there can be, it will be a new business center with a commercial space, wide roads, parking facilities, water and power. Unless this happens, we will always have pressure on our old cities. In Mapsa city, say Rupanda, Mapsa, Margaon, I have been all old cities which have organically grown. But they cannot handle the new infrastructure such as cars, water requirement and power. And if you are trying to make them high dense all over again, it's going to be a disaster. Unless we create an alternate way where the city can grow. So these are our, this is what I would say is something that has to be implemented right away. And if we need our Goa to remain beautiful, then the problems that I have addressed, if you think are the problems that are really there, should be addressed and taken forth by the present government. Thank you very much.